Welcome to the Faith Lutheran Church Sunday Morning Bible Study for February 26, 2017. Today, Pastor Jonathan Holmes leads us on a discussion of Psalm 6. Let's listen in.
All right, Psalm 6. Actually, let us go ahead and we'll begin with a word of prayer. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise for bringing us all here safely on this day, because it is in this place that we receive the forgiveness of our sins, life, and salvation through your Son, Jesus. But also, we ask that you send your Holy Spirit at this time as we look to your word, that we would see the ways of our salvation, and that it is always and still will be with Jesus Christ, the King who is set upon Zion, your holy hill. We pray through him all these things. Amen. Amen. All right, so we're looking at Psalm 6. And if somebody would be willing to read that for us, you are free in Christ to do so.
O Lord, do not rebuke me in your anger or discipline me in your wrath. Be merciful to me, Lord, for I am faint. O Lord, heal me, for my bones are in agony. My soul is in anguish. How long, O Lord, how long? Turn, O Lord, and deliver me. Save me because of your unfailing love. No one remembers you when he is dead. Who praises you from the grave? I am worn out from groaning. All night long I flood my bed with weeping and drench my couch with tears. My eyes grow weak with sorrow. They fail because of all my foes. Away from me, all you who do evil, for the Lord has heard my weeping. The Lord has heard my cry for mercy. The Lord accepts my prayer. All my enemies will be ashamed and dismayed. They will turn back in sudden disgrace.
All right. Thank you.
That was Psalms what?
Psalm 6. And so as I mentioned in the front of church, we're going to start going through the penitential psalms through Lent. And this is the first one, kind of in the order of things. It's only single digits, so of course it's one of the first. So this psalm is actually usually associated after being or written after David was convicted of his sin after, when Nathan came and told him that he had sinned after he'd laid with Bathsheba, and actually Bathsheba had conceived a son, and that David would end up killing her husband, essentially, maybe not with his own hand but with his orders to be at the front of the battle. And so this right here is how he is feeling after that being convicted by Nathan. Because he says, O Lord, rebuke me not in your anger, nor discipline me in your wrath. Who was I talking to after church? Here the law is clearly in David's mind. We as Lutherans like to distinguish between the law and the gospel, as I think I've mentioned that a few times. And so here the law has done its work. David thinks that he will be rebuked because of his sin. That he will be disciplined in wrath instead of love. How often do we feel that way with our sin, with our corruption? It's quite often, isn't it? So we plead, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. But we do it in very specific ways. In fact, David does it in a very specific way here. He says, be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am languishing. Heal me, O Lord, for my bones are troubled. Does anybody know how bones are associated with a person through Scripture? It's kind of their life. My bones are wilting away, they'll say. Not their flesh, but their bones, because in bones is the marrow, is that which gives us the blood we need to live. And so what David is saying here is my bones, my very being, my life is in languish. It is troubled. How does this display how David is feeling? You can answer back if you want to. I'm grabbing here, so.
Terrified.
And sorrowful.
And sorrowful, terrified.
The end of his rope.
End of his rope.
Probably the lowest you could go.
Probably, actually.
Maybe no hope, almost. Well, he has a little hope because he's praying for God's mercy.
Right, he has a little hope, and yeah, exactly. He's pleading to God's mercy, his graciousness. My translation has gracious, yours had mercy. I kind of like mercy better because it gives that courtroom scene again. When we talk about justification, we're pleading with the judge himself.
And he even says that, like, don't kill me now.
Yeah.
Because among the dead, no one proclaims your name. Who praises you from the grave? It's like, I can still do good if you just let me live a little bit longer.
Yeah.
Yeah. Give me another chance.
Yeah.
So when, in verse 3, when he's saying, in my translation, my soul is in anguish, how long, O Lord, how long? Is he's asking, how long am I going to stay like this before God would forgive him? How long am I going to be in this anguish? That's kind of how I would read it.
I would read it that way, too.
Okay.
You know, and that kind of brings up some of the stuff, you know, I'm never surprised when somebody says, why is all this bad stuff happening in the world if there's a God of love? When they're looking at the wrong place of where sin came from, we need to look at humanity itself, because that is why bad things happen. Not because of God necessarily, but because of people, sinful people, evil people. And so, everybody, you know, especially as a Christian, you go, oh Lord, how long do we have to endure all this suffering and anguish that we see? You know, my generation doesn't watch the news because of that. Because it's always bad news. It's all, and we've come to realize that a lot of it is ratings.
Yeah.
And so we don't watch it because now it's just another form of entertainment. Well, if I'm going to watch entertainment, I'm going to watch something that I'll enjoy a lot more than the news.
Yeah.
But then,
it's nothing but bad news.
But then your generation gets their news probably more from social media.
Well, yeah.
Which is
also a lot of fake news.
Yeah.
A lot of fake.
Not to quote somebody, fake news.
They always bait you, too. Like, I want to know what the weather's going to be. And they say a little bit about the weather, and they say more later.
Yeah.
You have to wait, like, 20 minutes
for
and terribleness.
That's an entertainment play right now.
That's a lead-in.
What do you mean?
Maddening.
Quote, fake news.
Oh, that's what Trump keeps
Trump
saying.
See? I don't watch the news, so I don't know that he's saying that. Granted, I don't have
I'm sure it's on the internet, too.
Yeah, but I still don't look at that. Because I'm more worried about this and getting it to you guys than I am.
But and I don't mean you so much as just that.
Well, the generation,
younger,
yeah.
Yeah, and how many people don't read? You know, forget newspapers because people don't read them, and now they're kind of like not watching the news on TV.
Mm-hmm.
So that really does kind of leave just the internet or what they hear from their friends, which is probably based on something that they heard somebody else say.
It's a game of telephone at that point.
Yeah.
That's like, you know, me growing up in the 60s, there was nothing but bad news my whole life growing up. Seriously, nothing but bad news. You know, the divorce of my parents when I was 2, mm-hmm. the feudal fighting in the family, which is crazy, the Vietnam War, you know, and watching people getting just wasted on the television, you know, and all, you know, the turmoil in the presidency with Nixon, you know, and then he gets, you know, ready to resign. Nothing, you think about it, our generation was brought up on bad news, and no wonder I'd say 89% of our generation suffers depression. because of all the bad news that we soaked up in a sponge.
But unfortunately,
and now I have a son who's 22 who does not watch one bit of television, not one bit of news on the radio or television, newspaper, nothing. And he's got the best attitude, positives. He's always happy, smiling. You know, he's just doesn't want to deal with any negative or bad thing, or doesn't want to hear anything bad.
But then,
It's like, you know,
this just really, the Holy Spirit has come upon me.
Yeah.
What is this with talking about this and the bad news? What does this show us, though?
People are evil.
Exactly.
Evil exists.
Evil exists. It's a sinful, fallen world.
Sure.
And that's always what has gotten reported, because you would have no ratings if all you did was give good news.
Why not?
People strive on bad news.
Yeah, why do people always stop and look?
Bad news?
Why do people always stop and look at an accident?
Yeah.
You know, we're just...
Because they were taught that. Their parents did. So it all...
My parents did.
No, I don't think it's that. I think it's just...
Curiosity.
And kind of fascinated with the morbid. And I mean, look at all of the increase in all the vampire and zombie and all that cult kind of...
Yeah.
Entertainment. You know, those movies.
Yeah.
But I do have a question kind of related to this, related to your sermon this morning.
Okay.
When you said that sin was our master...
Not now.
Okay, because you did. He did say it. I did hear it. And I thought, no.
Well, how did I say it?
It had to do with that pride and.
When we are sin is our master when we are proud.
Okay.
And then I continued with, but when we acknowledge our sin, we repent and receive the good news, receive forgiveness, that is when Christ is our master. And I maybe should have followed it up with that saying. Because like Paul says, you know, who am I always a slave of, according to Paul? Christ. Mm-hmm. He is always my master, which then is actual freedom. Whereas, you know, people see sin, you know, the debauchery, you know, all the bad stuff. Sometimes they see that as freedom. The sexual revolution really started something that people said it feels good, so it must not be bad. Mm-hmm. But that's actual enslavement to your flesh. They call it the sin of the flesh for a reason, because you've imprisoned yourself with your flesh, and not with righteousness. And of course, we can't do that without Christ. At the same time, when he grasps us and holds us down under the water, the very violent baptism that we all received, where the old Adam is killed and drowned so that the new Adam can rise. And, when Otto was born, I know we're getting sidetracked here, and that's okay. When Otto was born, I didn't text Pastor Koch that Otto was born. I said we have an escaped convict here.
How wonderful.
How wonderful that he's here. And now I want to bring him to the waters of holy baptism. And actually last week, I don't know why I said it, but he was talking to me while we were standing up there, and I said, would you shut up and just kill my son already? Because that's what's going to happen. And that's what happens in baptism. I wanted him to kill the old Adam in my son so that the new Adam could rise again and that he is a child of God. Because he's going to need it. When I look at the world around me, when I do catch any of the news, you know, I need him to know that there is hope, that there is purity, that there is righteousness, forgiveness in a world that preaches tolerance, but in the end, tolerance becomes intolerance, and so they're thrown to the side again anyway. But I want the good news. I want, you know, the gospel itself. It is the good news, that which saves lives. Now I'm preaching again, but...
It's okay.
Yeah.
Go, man.
Ah. That's why David pleads. This is such a good psalm after studying it this week. Turn, O Lord, deliver my life. Save me for the sake of your steadfast love. It's repentance. In order to understand repentance in the Hebrew sense, you must understand repentance as a 180-degree turn away from. It's a turn. David is telling the Lord to repent, to actually say that I am not a sinner, to turn his mind away from my sin, and instead look to the Messiah who is promised to me. Deliver my life. He is pleading for that. I love getting to know Greek and Hebrew. You know, because of this very thing right here, the turning away from all of my anguish. Don't look at my, pardon my French, but my crap. Look at my goodness, my righteousness instead that you have said I have.
Or it could be turning from his wrath to turning to his love.
Well, and mercy, yeah, exactly.
Which is really the focus on his nature rather than the nature of David.
But David's still, he's still hung up on his nature though. Because he's a fallen sin.
A God's nature or David's nature?
David's hung up on his
own
at this point. Yeah. Because, you know, when you're pleading, you have this sense of guilt typically. and if you don't, there's something, you're either just playing the game or whatnot, but at this point, there's still guilt because he's asking for deliverance. You don't ask for deliverance unless you've done something wrong.
But I don't know if he's really saying, turn from, and don't look at what I did wrong, and look at the little that I do right. I'm not sure if that's the
dream. No.
Yeah.
I didn't say anything about David's rightness. I said about the God's goodness. Yeah. He's turning him from David's inward looking to outside of himself to God himself.
Other translations say, return, mm-hmm. Lord, and deliver me. So it's kind of like, to me, that David is saying that God is walking away from him. He's going to abandon him because of his great sins. And he's saying, return. Yeah. You know, like, come back and let's talk about how... I can be help to you.
And that's why I mentioned repentance, mm-hmm. because it is, you're walking away, but then, you know, about face, and then you start walking towards again.
And sometimes the grief of your sin is so much that you're just looking at yourself too, and it blocks you from looking at God's mercy.
Oh yeah.
And so, some of the turning is,
you
can open your eyes to God's mercy.
That's what I always say. You know, it's not for job security for me that people come to church. It's for your security in Christ, because, you know, people, we're probably all guilty of it at some point in our life or not. You say, well, I can praise God on the golf course or in the boat or wherever it might be, and yes, you can, but you can't be forgiven there. Because there's nobody there to tell you that you are forgiven. But the authority of God, authority of Christ, that's why the pastor is so important. He has been given the authority to forgive sins. That's why we looked at John 20, where he's giving the apostles the authority to either withhold forgiveness for unrepentant sinners or to give forgiveness to repentant sinners.
So, if you were in a situation where there were no pastors for you to be able to go to a church to hear that forgiveness, can't you then say in your prayer to God, you know, that I ask for your forgiveness, and by the power and authority of your Son, I claim that forgiveness that you've promised me?
Yes and no. Because that's a hypothetical. Mm-hmm. I don't know of a place where you can't at least drive to a church. It may be a couple hours away. We have vehicles now. Mm-hmm. But, you know, speaking hypothetically, there have been instances in history where they don't have a pastor. He's died or whatnot. So what they'll do is then they'll call a person among them to be the pastor. Okay. He's usually probably a great lay theologian or whatnot, and so they call him to give the gifts. Because that office is there for a specific reason. Because you are not called to withhold forgiveness. I am.
Like in the battlefield and so forth, in the war, in the wars.
Well, and typically the help chaplains along there too. But I'm not saying that you can't say your sins are forgiven. I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying that I have, you know, talking about this morning, I have the degree or the certificate, if you will, that says I'm an ordained minister. And that doesn't, I'm not putting that up to show it off. I'm putting up that up there. It's like wearing the clerical collar. You know what my job is. You know why I'm here. And I'm here to forgive sins. Yes, withhold it if you're going to be unrepentant. But more, I want to give you the forgiveness. That's why it's there. I have the authority of Christ behind it. Because I've gone through the laying on of hands and the gift of the Holy Spirit. I was breathed on at my ordination. The laying on of hands. I was spirited. Because actually the word in John 20 where it says he breathed on them can also be translated as he spirited upon them. So he gave them their Holy Spirit for a specific reason. Now again, I'm not saying that we all don't, you know, you don't have the Holy Spirit. It's just, you know, when you think of vocation, I have a very different vocation than the rest of you. You know, you test out airplanes and jets and missiles and stuff like that. He's probably great. Put me in that same position, and I'm going to destroy you. Somebody. You know, that's why I go to school. I went to school for 4 years, and why we have, you know, maybe don't have. We also have programs where guys are taught in the field when we do need to call somebody out in the midst of us to do something. There's a reason for all of that. It's not just to go to school. It's to learn. You know, that it's funny. When my fourth year, I really want. I mean, you know, I was ready to go to call day because, you know, this is now my future in many respects. But I could care less if I could go to graduation, because all in the end is just handing me an empty folder. First off,
yes.
But that means nothing compared to what. That's just a formality at that point for me. Yes, sir.
Well, so you're saying, you know, we're forgiven even though we may not repent?
No.
But we're forgiven as long as we repent amid our sins.
Forgiveness of sins is there for everybody is what I'll say.
Okay, so like with the Catholics, though, it's like I remember the priest saying, well, you got to say 10 Hail Marys and 10 Our Fathers. Was that followed up with then you're forgiven? I mean, I don't know.
I don't know. I'm a Lutheran for a reason. I mean, I don't have to make satisfaction. I don't get to add to my justification. Because for Roman Catholics, baptism takes away original sin. Lutherans don't believe that. It saves us because it's the sign. It's that which we can look back to for the assurance of faith. The assurance of that which saves. Roman Catholics don't have that, because they think once you're baptized, officially anyway, not all the Catholic, you know, not all the person sitting in the pew believe this, but according to their official doctrine, you are no longer sinful in a sense, and that when you do, if you fall, if you will, you can make satisfaction for it by Hail Mary, quite contrary, how did you grow, or the, you know,
works righteousness.
It's all works righteousness.
Yeah.
Exactly, because they believe in free will, or we don't. Because, like I said, you know, we either our master's either sin or it's Christ. So we're either a slave to sin or a slave to Christ. One's an actual imprisonment, the other is actual freedom, and that's with Christ. And that's what David is pleading for. Hey, turn it back around to this psalm, because he is pleading for that. He is pleading, for in death there is no remembrance of you, and Sheol, who will give you praise? This is hell. Sheol is hell. It's H-E double hockey sticks. Or toothpicks, whichever one you grew up with. It's a pit. And I know you guys have talked excuse me, about when you went through Revelation. You know, that pit of fire, that lake of fire. This is what he is afraid of. Being burned in the pit. The fire pit.
Isn't he also afraid, though, that God has turned from him? But actually, it isn't God that turned from him. He turned from God.
Yes.
God never has turned from him.
God has never turned from him.
So when he says, turn, O Lord, and deliver me, he really, if this were a prayer that was being said today, post-Christ, we would be saying more, turn me back to you.
I think the anguish is explained.
The thing is, though,
because God didn't abandon
God
him.
Doesn't turn his back on us.
Right.
Because he turned his back on Christ.
Maybe he was
but what like David is saying is to return to the promises. Return to the promises you made from Genesis 3:15 on. That there will be a Messiah, that there will be salvation, that there is forgiveness.
Mm-hmm.
But the psalm ends with him acknowledging.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Right, exactly.
He's heard the prayer and he accepts it.
Because God has made two promises. God has made two promises. He's either promised wrath, he's promised wrath against sin, or he promises salvation to those of whom he has clutched in his grasp through the Word, the Holy Spirit. Because he does say, I will punish sin. Now, we've talked about unrepentance and repentance. You know, I had the discussion with one of the members back in Minnesota at my non-Missouri Synod church. Yeah, we'll talk about that later. But anyway, he was trying to understand forgiveness because there's objective forgiveness, which is John 3:16, for God so loved the world, they just gave his one and only son. But then there's the subjective, where he has died for his church, for those of whom he has in his grasp. Because there are those who are outside of grace, unfortunately. And so his judgment against that is hell. It's death, eternal death itself. I'm probably making things more muddy because I'm trying to figure this out
at the same time. No, I'm just thinking, though, that if you're saying that he died for those who follow him, yes, but didn't he also die for those who right now don't follow him so that there would be
right.
the hope that they could always...
And that they can look to it.
Right.
Because, you know, he died, you know, when it says for the sins of the whole world... It's talking about every single sin ever committed was placed on Christ by anybody. There's just some who continue to live in it, or some not have decided but have been grasped by the Word and the Holy Spirit, you know, through the forgiveness of sins, hearing that good news where God has finally elected them to be his child. There are those who then have the gift of eternal life. Now, we can very easily get into double predestination with this, and we're not going to, because God, you know, when Paul is talking subjectively, he's not talking objectively. When he says, you know, you have been elected, you know, the Calvinists, you know, they'll say, well, if you're elected to be God's child, then there must be the opposite. That's not the case, because Paul is talking to a very specific audience. He's talking about the people of whom he is writing to and which is this scripture is being read to. So it's much more subjective than objective. In fact, you know, we use those terms with justification, our declaration of righteousness before the Father. We talk about objective and subjective justification because the cross and the empty tomb, the resurrection, were for the whole world. And that is some place that people can find hope. Just some choose to reject it. And God loves them so much that if they choose to reject it, he'll let them. You know, it's God has been often described as a delinquent father because of that. And he is. His love is so abounding that if somebody chooses to go away from him, he'll let them. He'll cry out, come back, come back. And then he'll go out and try to grab them. But so it's like, you know, talking to one of your angry friends who starts walking away. You keep grabbing their arm, but they take it away and go, and they keep walking away. That's what I often picture with that. It's not until you say something, or time, I should say, where they will cool down and you can actually talk to them again and you can be absolved or absolve them or whatever it might be. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I'm weary with my moaning. Every night I flood my bed with tears. I drench my couch with my weeping. My eye wastes away because of grief. It grows weak because of all my foes. Just continues the same thing. Lord, have mercy on me, the sinner. Because this is the effect sin is having on me. I am weeping. You know, I thought of, when I read this just now, I thought of Jesus talking about there's a place of weeping and gnashing of teeth. This kind of ties back to then verse 5. You know, it is a place of weeping and gnashing and trouble.
But the foes that he's referring to, wouldn't those be more, again, his weaknesses, his sins? It's not necessarily his enemies. I mean, those things are an enemy of his, but he's not talking about literal people.
I think he is, but also not literal people. Talk about all of his enemies, those who tempt him, because
mm-hmm.
there's always constant temptation, especially in Israel, since, you know, Israel didn't do its job in purifying the land. There's always somebody there with war or whatnot, and it'd be just easy to go towards, you know, unity, at least a fake unity, where we can say, well, we all believe in the same thing, when we really don't. And that's a temptation. And because, you know, when you stop, you know, we see it with, unfortunately, a lot of our Christian brethren who buy into that, well, we all believe in the same thing. No, we don't, because those who say we all believe in the same thing also say it's okay to have an abortion or live together before marriage and all this kind of stuff. That's not the case. God has designed life and he has designed marriage for a specific reason. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So it would be physical as well as spiritual.
I think it's all of it. Mm-hmm. Because we, you know, too often we like to divide the spiritual from the physical. Scriptures don't do that. That's why, you know, it used to be, how was it worded after the service, or after you received, at the departure from the Lord's Supper? It used to be, now with this, the true body and blood of your Lord and your Savior Jesus Christ, strengthening the one true faith into life everlasting, depart in peace. It's been changed for a specific reason now to be, you know, now through this, the body and blood of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen you in body and soul into life everlasting. Because they're both connected. One cannot exist without the other. And so that's why I think it's typically both.
Okay.
Because all the temptation, all the evil comes from the physical at the same time as the good. Because the good comes from blood being shed on the cross. It comes from a body resurrected. It's, you know, people try to over-spiritualize things far too often. That's why I like being a Lutheran. We actually have substance. We are the most earthly, if you will, most materialistic, because we have body and blood in with through bread and wine. We have water. We have real things of which God has attached himself to. And so none of those promises exist without physical means. So, you're welcome.
One more thing about this.
Yeah.
Is that David says, I'm worn out. This wasn't the first night.
Oh, yeah.
When he started his prayer.
Right.
He's been at it a while. you know, with the his bones being where he's he said, I'm weary with my groaning all night. I make my bed swim. So there's been lots of tears.
There's been lots of tears.
This wasn't his first night.
He's probably depressed.
Did he stay with Bathsheba?
She became one of his wives, yeah. Because I think, isn't it through Bathsheba that we get Solomon? If I remember right?
I think you're right. But you would think if he was really sorry, he wouldn't.
Well, except...
except that she was a widow now.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, she's a widow, but she's... People don't realize that when you have sex, you are now married in God's eyes. Perfect example. There's two examples I'm thinking of right now. Samson, when he married his first wife, never consummated it. And they actually, the Jews did not see it as actual marriage. Because they did not consummate it. There's also the instance where Jesus is at the well with a Samaritan woman, and mm-hmm. she goes. He says, call out your husband. And she goes, well, I'm not married. Actually, you're right. You're not married to one person, but you're actually married to five people of whom you've known in the biblical sense. So there's a lot of married people who don't realize that walking around living in sin, especially when they get... promiscuous, because you're actually married to a whole bunch of people at that point in God's eyes. That's why then we have the gift of forgiveness, thanks be to God, even for those people, because the Lord has heard my plea, or my cry for mercy is the NIV. I kind of like the cry for mercy idea. But the Lord accepts my prayer. All my enemies shall be ashamed and greatly troubled. They shall turn back and be put to shame in a moment. This is pointing to the cross, right here. The moment of the cross, where Satan is thrown down into hell and chained up. That's the shame, that's Satan being ashamed, being put to shame. That is the cross for us. That's where God says, I have heard your pleas for mercy. Now here's my son. Yes, he lived the perfect life in submission to me, but he is the innocent sacrifice that I'm willing to make for you. So David has got the Messiah in the back of his head at this point. Because there's a promise that the Messiah will come to save the nation of Israel from its sin. It's funny. What seems to be a shameful showing of weakness, Christ on the cross, you know, it is, I think you've heard this before, where, you know, Jesus always got a loincloth or whatever on. Well, in fact, that they would always actually crucify them naked. And so you would show all of your shame at that point. But in that shameful, shame-filled moment is actually the fulfillment of all forgiveness and righteousness. That's why, you know, as Lutherans, we also talk about theology of the cross and theology of glory. You know, we're all guilty of it. You know, we're always theologians of glory because all we want to see is Christ on the cloud with somebody in his arms or whatnot, or he's got a scepter and he's sitting on a throne, when the throne actually is where he's crowned with thorns. It's on the cross. It's in bloodshed. That's why some people can't stand Christianity, because, you know, we talk about blood, we talk about grotesqueness, we talk about killing people, we talk about eating somebody. In fact, in the early church, there was a Roman spy who called the Christians cannibals because they eat their God. Human reason just can't grasp that. And human reason will, in the end, take us away from Christ. You know, when Luther says in the first article, the meaning of the first article, you know, he has given me my body and soul, eyes, ears, and all my members, my reason and all my senses. He's not talking about human, like the human reason. He's talking about the common sense, the good reason that only I can get through being a Christian, the reason of grasping that which God has provided through Christ, grasping his gifts. It just doesn't translate very well in English. There's a lot of untranslatable German words, just as there is with every language, into English. So, yes, ma'am.
For your own personal repentance,
mm-hmm.
It seems sometimes God has protected us from descending to such despair over our sins, because you think about Jesus and what he did for us and the shame he had,
mm-hmm.
that we don't have any. And it's almost like almost immediately you cry with gratefulness.
Oh, yeah.
Almost more, well, of course you're sad for what you do and your sinful condition, but I think almost more than that, you're just grateful for what Jesus did. I don't know how to say. So we don't have to, you know, kind of feel like that almost. You know what I'm
saying?
We're
freed from that.
Set free from that. It's just we're saint and sinner at the same time.
Yeah.
And so we fall into the weeping because all we have being before us is our sin. That's why there's kind of a reinsurgence of private confession and absolution with the pastor, because there's that sin that can bother us so bad, and we need to go and take it to the pastor because he is there for that reason, to hear that and then not say Hail Mary or Our Father or do this good work. No, he just says, okay, your sins are forgiven. I always place my hand upon the head of the person who's confessing, because there's something very real taking place right here.
Yeah.
Your sins are being forgiven so that you can live with a good conscience. Because in the end, that is God's will for our life, is to live with a good conscience.
Because Satan is the accuser who will make you feel like this too.
Oh, yeah.
And make you think and hide God's grace from you too.
Oh, yeah.
Like, he doesn't want you to see God's
grace. Nope. And he'll work on us the hardest.
Yeah. But it's like, through Jesus, you can say, get behind me, Satan.
Oh, yeah.
You don't have anything to do with me.
Right.
Because I have Jesus, my Lord.
But that's why we need to be brought to Jesus as often as possible, so we can... Because, you know, I'm a student of history at the same time as everything else. People's memory does not last very long.
Yeah.
Everybody keeps saying that this... Yeah, they keep calling Trump Hitler. He's not Hitler.
Mm-mm.
There's no way he's Hitler. He doesn't have millions of Jews dead or people dead. He's not Stalin. He's not Mussolini. He's not a despot. Yet. No, I'm
maybe
just
that's what they're worried about, the yet.
Well, and that's just it. We're always worried about the yet,
yeah.
Instead of the now. Mm-hmm. And the now can affect the yet. You know, when we have the now with the forgiveness, that affects how I live my life in freedom.
Well, and it's just like with anxiety, I think they say that 90% of the things that you get so anxious over never even happened.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
And so we're taking all of this energy and focusing it on all of that negativity, and that's where... Then I try to remember, I don't have to be anxious about this.
Yeah.
Because Christ is going to, whatever it is,
I've really come to hate the question, what if, because of that. Because we're always talking about what if, mm-hmm. instead of the what. What is Christ? The what if, in the end, does it matter? No. What matters is that Christ is for you and that you have the promise of eternal life, the gift of eternal life, forgiveness, life, and salvation. In the end, that's what matters. Which is why, you know, Luther is taken out of context when he says, you know, sin boldly. He's actually writing that to Melanchthon, who has not left his home for quite a while because he is so concerned that he's going to sin, that he's essentially wasting away. But now he says, go sin boldly because you are forgiven. When you sin, what of it? Look at the devil in the face and say, God is, you know, God has sent Christ for me. He's atoned for me. It's all on him now. Don't tell me that I'm the sinner. In fact, Christ became sin. He who knew no sin, as Paul writes, became sin, the very essence of sin, the very personification of sin. He was the worst sinner in world history. And he's done it for you, to take it away from you, so that you can live a life boldly with a good conscience. So, I always end up preaching at these things. Oh, well.
And we love it.
Oh, good. I'm glad. Well, God's blessings to your day and your week.
Thank you.
Remember that your sins are forgiven, that you are righteous in Christ. And if you haven't gotten that out of the Bible study, make sure that you hear that now. So,
thank you.
God's blessings.
Thanks for listening to this Bible study presentation from Faith Lutheran Church in Moore Park, California. For more information, visit us on the web at faithmoorpark.com.